They're an entire culture dedicated to a common goal, working together as one to turn a lifeless rock into a garden.
Terraforming, turning an uninhabitable planet into a home for humans. The staple of any good sci-fi story. And according to Elon Musk, it's something that we actually might end up doing.
When do I think we can go to Mars? I mean, I think possibly as soon as 5 years from now.
Is Elon right about terraforming Mars? I mean, is it realistic?
That's a great question, Satara. I'm a space scientist, and over the next few minutes, I'm going to break down whether terraforming Mars would be possible. But first, if you enjoy this video, make sure to let YouTube know by liking, subscribing, and leaving a comment. Some planetary bodies are harder to terraform than others. Some, like Mars, might just need a little nudge, relatively speaking. For example, terraforming the moon would be a lot harder than terraforming Mars. And Mars might even be impossible. But if you want to go to Mars, you need to go to Mars. Mars has rather favorable characteristics for supporting life. It has a good mix of materials, rocky surface, similar length of day to Earth, and great gravity that's not way too high or way too low. It's atmosphere is also just way too thin. So it's not really a problem. But Mars has an average surface area of 1.5 degrees Celsius, which is about 1.5 degrees Fahrenheit. And that's pretty important. Mars has an average surface temperature of minus 65 degrees Celsius. That's partly because Mars is just further away from the sun than Earth is, but also partly because Mars's atmosphere is only 1.5 degrees Celsius thicker than the sun. Carbon dioxide is particularly important because it's great at trapping heat. Just ask Venus. Carbon dioxide is why Venus is hotter than Mercury, even though Venus is further away from the sun. And it's also part of the reason why Earth has been slowly getting hotter over the last few hundred years. So to put it simply, intentional global warming on Mars is part of how we get Mars to be able to support life. Mars has a bunch of carbon dioxide locked up in its polar ice caps, and you just need some initial warming to unlock that. This warming could be localized as well. You don't need to heat up the whole planet for this, you just need to heat up the poles. There would be a few ways to do this. One would be to use massive orbital mirrors to reflect more sunlight to the poles. Another would be to drop nuclear bombs on the poles. In terms of the amount of mass that you'd need to bring from Earth to Mars, this could be a relatively efficient way to kickstart Martian global warming. But if you know anything about me, you'd know that I'm certainly not an advocate for putting nuclear weapons in rockets. And anyway, terraforming Mars by nuking it would take more energy than the total amount of energy in all the nuclear weapons at the peak of Cold War. To generate a bunch of heat at once, we could also drop big rocks on the poles, like really, really big rocks. An asteroid 30 meters wide would create about as much energy as a 1 megaton W-39 Minuteman 1 warhead. We'd just have to deflect a bunch of asteroids that just happen to be passing Mars at just exactly the right time, so they hit in exactly the right spot, and how hard can that be? Orbital mirrors could be better than dropping nukes or asteroids on Mars in the longer term, because you get to keep using them after you've had that initial warming. We could also build factories on Mars to start producing chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs, which were those pesky chemicals that started to create the ozone hole. We phased CFCs out on Earth when we started to realize how much damage they were causing and replaced them with hydrofluorocarbons, or HFCs, in what was probably the most successful environmental campaign of all time. But CFCs would be very effective at warming Mars. Let's focus on mass-producing materials, because in the longer term, it's probably the most effective way to unlock the atmosphere that's locked up in the ice and in the ground. This is a nanorod. It can be designed with the optimum optical properties to let sunlight in, but trap the long-wave thermal radiation as it leaves the planet so that it locks more heat in. Once you release the nanorods, in theory, the global winds should be sufficient to distribute them across the entire planet. So, in theory at least, you'd only need one central manufacturing point. Once released, each particle would stay in the atmosphere for an average of about 10 years. Terraforming researcher Edwin Kite estimates that you'd need about 1.5 million tons of nanorods to be released per year to terraform Mars, which is around 4,000 tons per day. Now that is a lot of mining, but not an insurmountable amount if you have a sufficiently large colony on Mars with, you know, some kind of heavy industry. But it does seem likely that you'd need either a large colony or massive automation on Mars to be able to manufacture the nanorods. That's just way too much material to bring from Earth. So, okay, let's say we manage to use one or more of these methods we've just talked about to kickstart the terraforming on Mars. We've got some warming. All right, now what? What you'd be hoping for would be to reach a tipping point, which is when other processes take over and start taking care of the global warming for you. Tipping points are kind of scary for us here on Earth in the context of global warming. So, for example, you've got permafrost, say, in Siberia, ice that just doesn't melt on a year-to-year basis, but a little bit of global warming, and you start to melt more of that ice, which starts to release a bit more gas, that creates more global warming, which therefore melts more ice and releases more gas, and suddenly you've got a runaway process that you can't really control. But on Mars, tipping points could actually be really helpful. Once we've warmed the surface enough, that starts to melt more of the ice under the ground, which releases more gas and creates more warming, and so on. Okay, so now Mars has warmed up, you've melted the ice, you've got a little bit of an ocean. What does that look like? We know that Mars has a relatively low elevation in the northern hemisphere, so we might expect to see a large ocean in the north and a lot of land in the south. If we only melted the ice in the polar ice caps, we'd have about enough water to make an ocean about 30 meters deep on average if spread across the whole planet. But we know that one third of Mars has ice trapped under its surface, so releasing that would help grow our ocean. Okay, so now we've got a nice warm surface, check. We've got an ocean, check. We've got a thicker atmosphere, check. Now we need to install some kind of biosphere. We need to start installing life on the planet. One possibility to get started would be to seed the oceans with phytoplankton. Once they've populated the ocean, then you introduce zooplankton, and then you introduce fishes. Plants would need nutrient-rich soil to be able to grow in, but Mars isn't very nutrient-rich. If you planted plants on Mars now, they would pretty much just die. We could throw in some fungi and nitrogen-fixing bacteria. This would absorb the nitrogen and turn it into nitrate compounds, which would be able to feed other plants. Because Mars has a lower gravitational strength than Earth, at about one third, we'd expect plants to grow taller, so we might get some pretty giant trees. The Martian biosphere, initially, and maybe even long-term, will not be as flexible as Earth's, so it'll be very fragile. If plants grow too much and too quickly, then that will absorb a lot of carbon dioxide and remove it from the atmosphere so the planet might cool again. If a certain species dies out, many other species could collapse. The ecosystem would probably need careful observation and interventions here and there to make sure that things stay on track, maybe forever. So how long would all this take? All right, make no mistake, even under the most optimistic scenarios, this is a multi-generational project. You or I will never see the result of a terraformed Mars. The most optimistic estimates are about 100 years, but range out to about 100,000 years.
But wait a minute, isn't Mars missing a magnetic field?
Well, that's true, and you might have heard that would mean that any atmosphere we create through terraforming would just get stripped away into space by the sun. And over a really, really long time span, yeah, that's basically right. Atmosphere does get stripped away from Mars, but atmosphere gets stripped away constantly from Earth too. So over shorter timescales on Mars, it's actually not that much atmosphere getting stripped away. Basically, you can think about it like we just need to keep filling up the bathtub faster than the bathtub is being emptied. At the moment, Mars is losing atmosphere at the rate of about 2 to 3 kilograms per second, which we know thanks to the Maven spacecraft. So we just need to create more atmosphere than is being lost per second. One analogy that I've heard from Edwin Kite is that it's not like filling up a bathtub that's going to start overflowing, it's more like filling up a bathtub while a cat is sipping at it. So as it turns out, Mars' lack of magnetic field would probably not stop us. And even if it would, there are proposals for solutions that might be able to create an artificial magnetic field of sorts, like putting an artificial magnetosphere between the Sun and Mars. Now this would also be a huge engineering feat. I've seen a few estimates for how much energy this would require, from around one nuclear power plant to all of the energy that humans used on Earth in 2020. Even if a magnetic field doesn't matter that much for atmosphere loss, it still does matter for radiation. A thicker atmosphere would give you a little bit more protection against solar and cosmic radiation, but the amount of radiation you receive on Mars would still be quite a lot greater than you'd receive on Earth. And that's even though Mars is further away from the Sun than Earth is. So early colonists would probably want to spend most of their time underground, shielded by several meters of dirt, even after Mars has some atmosphere. Well, so there you have it. Is it technically possible to terraform Mars? Yeah, probably. Is it practical? Probably not. And will we ever do it? Who knows? In my recent video, I talked about the discovery that Mars has enough liquid water under the surface to make an ocean about 1 to 2 kilometers deep. So I'd recommend checking out that video here. See you soon.